mercies never fail. How good is he? He saves, oh, he rescues, he redeems. Oh, his grace sets captives free. How good is he?
Good is he? Honor you, Lord. lead the first part of the service today. And we've got Gary Woodall, our regional minister, who I'm sure is known to most of you, will be preaching later on. As you can see, our table communion is set for later on. And you know, if you believe Jesus is your Lord and Saviour, you'll be welcome to join in with us. And those that are at home live streaming, and you've got 20 minutes or so to sort out something, you can join us with. I like to start a service with a psalm. I think it's quite traditional, quite an old custom. Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. The world and all its people belong to him. For he laid the earth's foundation on the seas and built it on the ocean depths. Who may climb the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? Only those whose hearts and hands are pure, who do not worship idols and never tell lies. They will receive the Lord's blessing and have right relationship with God their Saviour. Such people may seek you and worship in your presence, O God of Jacob. Open up ancient gates, open up ancient doors. Let the King of Glory enter. Who is the King of Glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord invincible in battle. Open up ancient gates, open up ancient doors, and let the King of Glory enter. Who is the King of Glory? The Lord of Heaven's armies. He is the King of Glory.
Thank you. We thank you for your
promise you'll be with us when we're gathered in your name. And Lord, here we are in your name, and we welcome your presence. Lord, pray your blessing on the rest of the service. Pray your blessing on Gary as he comes and talks to us and preaches for us. In your name, amen.
Don't know if you're about like me, Christmas is on its way. We went into a shop in the Lake District in the summer, and there they were, Christmas cards, Christmas paper. It was all there in preparation. Over the last number of years, as a network of Baptist churches across the west of England, we supported together the churches in Albania in Christmas outreach. And the reason that I'm sharing it with you now is just preparation time to get this done. Historically, we've managed to send over 5,000 boxes each year to Albania, and teams from the network of churches have gone across, shared with the folks in Albania what's been happening. But I just want to start off and actually say thank you to you at Clevedon Baptist Church. Thank you for the years of filling in boxes, and especially thank you for last year when, because of the pandemic, we couldn't go in person and send things from here. We raised around £13,000 together that was sent to Albania. The Albanian Baptist Union bought things. Instead of wee boxes, it became wee bags and people's stuff bags. It also went to various places. It went to young people and children, and this last year, for the first time, they managed to actually get into some of the children's hospitals and actually just share something of the love of Jesus. As you know from Albania, the history from the government is actually God doesn't exist, and it's a prime opportunity to go and share with a whole new generation of God's grace, God's blessing, and God's goodness. Each of the bags actually are filled cost between £12 and £15. And I know many people enjoy getting together, filling up boxes and actually doing something. So we came up with a list of things that people could do. Now, if that's one of you, I would suggest having a go. That may be setting up a Facebook birthday page and ask people to give. It may be that you've got something to sell it on eBay and give the money to the wee bags in Albania. It may be you do a sponsored something, or you set up a coffee morning. It's a prime opportunity for us together to share with our brothers and sisters in Albania and to share the love of Christ with a new generation. So on the one hand, I want to say thank you, and on the other hand, I want to say, well, at the moment there's nothing in the pot. So how can we help these brothers and sisters in Albania with that? And if you can help with that as individuals, and if you can help with that with a church, that would be fantastic. It would be fantastic, wouldn't it, to see in the new year what changes and different it makes to these group of people. Thank you.
So, as you may know, we are twinned with a church in Albania, a Magape church in Tirana, and just short time of prayer for them and their ministry at the moment. Lord, we pray for Agape Church. We pray for them in all the struggles that they're going through, the world is going through at the moment, and Albania in particular. Lord, we praise you and we thank you that they are preparing people for baptism. Lord, we pray for each one of those people they're preparing, that they will feel your touch, your protection with them, and that their witness will be an encouragement to others in the church and in the surrounding area to come to learn about you, to come into a relationship with you. We pray for the church in general as they plan on restarting some of their groups, their small groups, and other ministries. And pray especially for Fadron as taking more and more charge of the ministry this year. Lord, we thank you for the Agape Church. We thank you for our brothers and sisters there. And Lord, we pray that as we know they're praying for us, we pray for them, that you will bless them and look after them in all they're doing. Amen.
between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. And through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living God. Who could imagine so great a mercy? One heart could fathom such boundless grace. The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on. Yours is the victory. Lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
If you have a Bible, it'll be helpful for you to turn to 1 Timothy chapter 1. 1 Timothy and chapter 1, and we're going to be looking at verse 12 to 17. I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength, that he considered me trustworthy, appointing me to his service. Even though I once was a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man, I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. The grace of our Lord Jesus was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and the love that are in Christ Jesus. Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. For that very reason, I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his immense patience as an example of those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. Now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. Father God, I just pray as we just spend these few moments opening up your word, that you'll open up our eyes, in especially our hearts, to remember again your immense grace to us. So come by your Holy Spirit, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. I know over the past few weeks, Anthony has told me over the past few weeks, you've been looking at people's stories, is that correct? And that there's been times when in the service, people shared their own story. In some ways, I would like to do that again, but he's already done that. But telling each of us have got a story, haven't we? And we've got a story to tell. Those of us who know the Lord Jesus for ourselves, we've got a story. And as we look at this passage, I believe Paul's story is very similar to yours and to mine. It's a story of amazing grace. God's abundance given to us when we least expected it or deserved it. But there are times, isn't there, when we actually forget about all of that. And that was the problem that Paul was writing here in 1 Timothy. So he writes to this young evangelist placed in Ephesus, that the church that Paul planted, and he writes to them because he wants to warn them against false teachers being around. These false teachers saying, actually, you can make your way to God in your own effort, in your own strength. That was Paul's worst nightmare in some ways. And actually what's happened exactly as Paul expected. This is what Paul writes earlier on. They want to be teachers of the law, but they don't know what they're talking about. That's blunt, isn't it? Or what's so confidently affirmed. We know that the law is good if one uses it properly. We also know that the law is made not for the righteous, but for the lawbreakers and rebels, the ungodly, the sinners, the unholy, the religious. These people somehow have misunderstood the law of God. They weren't allowing the Bible to show up and reflect back what their life is really like. I know it's quite a few years ago when I was 12 years of age. And I went to hear an evangelist called Dick Saunders. Those of you who are over 60 will know Dick Saunders. I have to tell you, as a 12-year-old, I haven't got a clue with the word he said. All I know, he preached for a very, very, very long time. But it was amazing because at the end, he asked people if they want to become Christians, come forward. And there was a group of 12 lads sat at the back, and I was one of them. And we watched, and we all looked at each other and nudged each other, and we all got up and we came to the front. Confession, is that okay? We watched because all the girls were going to the front and a bunch of 12-year-old lads were just interested what's going on here. So we followed the girls. So we came to the front. Our leaders just couldn't understand what was going on. But there was something dramatically happened because they split us up. And I remember sitting down with this young chap and he opened up the Bible. Now, listen carefully. I've never been a drunkard. I've never been a drug taker. I never committed murder, okay? But when he opened up Scripture and we read it, all of a sudden, even as a 12-year-old, I knew I was not perfect enough to meet God. I can't explain what happened at that point. All he did is read Scripture, and Scripture just reflected back something of my life, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You know, there are times, even as a Christian, we stop allowing Scripture to reflect back the truth of us. I still imagine myself, by the way, of being 8 stone. Terry, you may know a bit of that. Being 8 stone, black hair, young, fit, vibrant. I think of myself as that. Do you know what I mean by that? But when I look into a mirror, I see myself as a middle-aged, grey, fat, lazy. So the best thing to do is not look into the mirror. Or look into the mirror and see something else. And actually, often when we come to Scripture, we do exactly the same thing. We don't allow Scripture and, as Paul talks about here, the law, show up what's really there. We think it's for other people, or we transfer it to something else, but it's not us anymore. Somehow we're good enough in our own eyes to stand before God. We're good enough in our own strength to stand before God. This is what the false teachers here are teaching God's people. It's okay, you can do it yourself. But Paul says, no, this isn't right. Each of us are sinners. Hang on a minute. Forgiven. Shown grace, shown mercy. Listen to what Paul writes here. I thank Christ Jesus, our Lord, who has given me strength. He considered me trustworthy, appointed me to his service, even though I was a blasphemer, a persecutor, a violent man. I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. The grace of our Lord Jesus was poured out to me abundantly, along with faith and love that was in Christ Jesus. Now, those words are not the normal words we think of Paul. We think of bold, strong, righteous, courageous, a man of faith. That the person who plants the church amongst the Gentiles. That the one who writes, it seems, most of the New Testament. Reliable. But Paul says, hang on a minute. That's not true. Listen to his words again. Even though I once was a blasphemer, a persecutor, a violent man, I was shown mercy because I act in ignorance in my unbelief. Here he was. In all his openness and honesty. You may look at me as someone good, he says, but the reality is I'm someone very different. And that's what my life was all about. When he stands up in front of Agrippa later on in Acts, he says this: I too was convinced that I ought to do all this possible to oppose the name of Jesus of Nazareth. And this is just what I did in Jerusalem. On the authority of the chief priest, I put many of the Lord's people in prison, and they were put to death. I cast my vote against them. Many a time I went out from one synagogue to another to have them punished. I tried to force them to blaspheme. I was so obsessed with persecuting them that I even hunted them down in foreign cities. That's what his life was like. But then we read these amazing words, don't we? In Acts chapter 9. Do you remember? On the road to Damascus, when he was going against God's people to persecute them, God met him. For him, it was just like a blinding light. Interesting with Paul, he didn't fully understand who it was initially. I do like this Christian who God tells, go and speak to Paul in Straight Street. I think he had a tremendous lot of faith, by the way. going to speak to the persecutor of the Christians and tell him that Jesus loved him. And he does. And he goes and he speaks to Paul. And the scales of Paul's eyes come off and he realizes who Jesus is. You see, the persecutor of Christ, the persecutor of Christ's body is transformed and changed. His life is turned upside down. Do you remember, what's his name again? John Newton? Do you remember John Newton? A slave trader, a vile man. I mean, vile. But he met the Lord Jesus, and things changed. He wrote a hymn, and I think we're going to put the words up. Can you put the words up? Do you remember this hymn?
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I'm free. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved.
Story is similar to the Paul's, isn't it? 'Twas grace. When I least expect it, God came. 23 years of age, everything dramatically changed for him. On his epitaph, this is what's written about John Newton. John Newton, clerk. Once was an infidel in Libertine, a servant of slaves in Africa, was by the rich mercy of our Lord Jesus, Savior Jesus Christ, preserved, restored, pardoned, and appointed to preach the faith he had so long labored to destroy. Paul's words, I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. Paul just didn't know what he was doing. He persecuted God's church. The grace of our Lord Jesus was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and the love that's in Christ Jesus. Things changed. For me, that was when I was 12 years of age. Do you remember back for you? When the Lord Jesus came and made himself known, and it was just like scales coming from your eyes, didn't it? Once you didn't believe, now you believe. Once you were in darkness, now you were in light. Everything changed. So what can we learn from Paul and in his story here? I think the one thing we can actually definitely learn, that none of us are too bad to be used by God. None of us, whoever you are, whatever your story is. I've been a pastor for too many years and sat down with too many people who've said all sorts of things to me. Gary, I am not so good as them. I've heard those stories. I've heard the stories, Gary, if you knew me, you would definitely not ask me to do anything in church. Gary, how could God use me? I have no gifts at all. Let me just say to you, if he can use Paul, he can use you. If he had a task for Paul, he definitely has a task for you. And as I look at Scripture, it seems to be that's God's pattern, isn't it? He uses the weak to overcome the strong. He uses those who think they know nothing to actually come against those who think they're wise in human standards. I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength, that he considered me, listen to Paul's words, trustworthy, appointing me to his service. Just look at King David. When Samuel came along when he was a shepherd boy, he ignored him. Just leave him alone. Let's see the big lads. Let's see the brave lads. But King David was the one that God said, I see his heart. What about people like Rahab, the prostitute, or Ruth, the foreigner? Each of these had a special place in God's plan, in tasks. You see, it doesn't depend on you. It all depends on him. It's by grace, as scripture says, we're saved. Through faith. Not anything you can do yourself. It's what God's done for you. You see, Paul had a real conviction here. Have a look at verse 15. Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came in the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. Listen carefully. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. And what does Paul say? I am the worst. Not I was. And we can hear our Christian stories sometimes, wasn't it? I was like this, but now I'm different. And by God's transforming grace and love, we can be different. But even Paul now, you know, the writer of the New Testament, the bold church planter, he says, I am of the worst. I have to say, what I'm talking about this morning goes against all the teaching of the age, doesn't it? The self-help books, how to make yourself better, to feel better. Actually, when we look at scripture, there is an aspect here that where God reflects back his amazing love to us and says, I accept you. I think you're wonderfully made, created by me. But as we look at scripture too, just like Paul does here as a follower of the Lord Jesus, says, I'm the worst here. I'm the worst of sinners. I don't deserve anything. This year, a few weeks ago, I had my second, is it privilege? Opportunity to go to court and to be a juror. Why? This is the second time in 5 years. My wife's never gone. Maybe it's her turn next time. But it's easy, isn't it? It's easy to be a juror, sat in the box, listening to all the evidence in front of you, and you determine if they're guilty or if they're innocent. Or you could be like the people that who come to the Crown Court just to watch all the cases. And by the way, there are people like that. And they sit there and they sit back and think, oh, they're really guilty, even though they haven't said a word yet. Have you noticed we could be exactly the same? Lord, I'm glad I'm not so bad as them. We don't verbalize it often, but we do think it. And we sit in judgment, either in the gallery or in the jury, and we condemn other people around us. Jesus told this amazing parable. To some who were confident of their own righteousness, those sat in the gallery and the jury, and looking down on everyone else, Jesus told this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. By the way, let's be really blunt here. The tax collectors are the worst of the worst. Is that okay? Not today, but then. They moved away from their religion. Actually, they even despised the people from their own nation. So they are the worst. They're the worst in the story. One a Pharisee, the other tax collector. The Pharisee stood up himself and prayed, God, I thank you that I'm not like other people, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week and give a tenth of all I get. But the tax collector stood up at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but he beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and all those who humble themselves will be exalted. What was Jesus' words? It's not the healthy who needs a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but the sinners. And Paul in our text says, I am the worst of sinners. I want to encourage us to actually face the reality sometimes, even those of us who are Christians, allow Scripture to speak to our lives. Allow Scripture to show up those areas that's not right with God, those things that we keep to ourselves, which no one else knows, but actually God does, and he wants to burst in and transform those areas. Let me ask you, as a Christian too, I wonder if you've forgotten that you're a sinner. It's not a word we often use in church either, is it? A sinner saved by grace. Or are you still trying to work out your salvation by somehow being more righteous than you are? There are moments, and I have to say moments in my Christian life, when I sit down and I open Scripture again and I wonder why God ever loves me. I know myself too well. Why do you love me, Lord? Why do you accept me? Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, whom I am the worst, Paul says. I have to say, there's only one group of people that will never be forgiven in our world. As I look at Scripture, there's only one group of people. That's the group of people who think they can do it on their own. That's the only group of people who can never be forgiven. Everybody else who actually says, God, I can't do it, I'm the worst of sinners, you know me through and through, I accept your forgiveness and your love, those group of people can be totally forgiven. Don't be fooled with false teaching to believe somehow you can make it on your own. Maybe you're not a Christian. Maybe you've tried for so long to make yourself right with God. Can I just encourage you today? Give up. Stop. It won't work. Admit with Paul, you're the worst of sinners. At that point, you see, Jesus is able to come into your life and transform you. Because that's why he came into the world, isn't it? Died on the cross, rose again. You see, Paul was living proof of God's grace and God's mercy. John Newton, remember that slave trader who sang about and sang the song that he wrote? He said to a friend when he was dying, my memory is nearly gone, but two things I remember, that I am a great sinner, that Christ is a great Savior. But for this very reason, I was shown mercy, so that in time, in verse 16, that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his immense patience and as an example for all those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. You see, you've got a story to tell. absolutely a great story. It may not be written in a book. They may never make a film of your story, but you've got a story that can transform other people's lives. Let me encourage you to have courage to share that story. When you're at the gates of a school, or maybe when a friend of yours is going through difficulties, uncertainty because of health, you've got a great story to share. Your story is an important story. Maybe it's someone you sit by on a train or a bus. You know, people do want to speak to you in those situations. And telling your story becomes a fascinating one. Just like as we read Paul's story, it becomes amazing. And through Paul's story, other people actually discover Jesus for themselves and has a story. And you could be exactly the same as that. Paul's a walking example of that story. Then Paul, at the end of this passage, seems to break out in song, a bit better than I did, by the way. And it was spontaneous, but they helped me get in tune at the beginning. Here's Paul breaks out in song, and this is his song. Sorry, I can't sing it to you because I don't know the notes. But here's the words. Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. God saved me by his amazing grace. God's immense. He's bigger than your imagination. God's loving, greater than you would ever experience. He's above us and beyond us. At the same time, he's right here beside us. We can't fully understand him, but at the same time, he's able to make it possible for us to grasp just a little of it. This story, this experience of Paul, just led him into praise and to worship for who God was and who God is. Listen this morning, scripture does tell us what we're really like, but it also reveals to us what God is really like when he bursts into our lives and when all that guilt suddenly goes, when we give up trying to do something in our own strength and he just overwhelms us with his love. Can I invite you just to close your eyes at the moment? Maybe some of us know our sin too well and we've carried it for so long, even those who are Christians, and we just need to come to God again and receive something of his grace. Can I invite you just to ask him? Maybe there's even others of us who never received God's grace, and today he says, come to me. If we confess our sins, he will cleanse us from all unrighteousness, it says. Lord Jesus, I just want to say thank you, thank you, thank you so much that you loved each of us so very much. You came and gave up your life for us. I don't know why you did it, Lord, because I know myself too well, but I thank you loved us so much, Lord, that you showed us grace, love upon love. You showed us mercy, undeserved favor. And instead of putting punishment on us, you put forgiveness on us. And you take punishment for us. Lord, thank you so very, very, very much that you loved us, you loved me that much. Thank you for your grace, for your mercy. Thank you that we have a story to tell of an amazing God. Amen. Mm-hmm. That's why this meal becomes such an important meal. It's not by my strength, by my might. It's by his grace and his mercy. Paul says, the tradition that I handed on to you comes from the Lord itself. On the night of his arrest, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, saying, this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Come, Lord Jesus, feed us with your love today and renew us with your life as we eat to remember. In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup, poured out wine and said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me. Come, Lord Jesus, fill us with your love and renew us with your life. As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So, Lord Jesus, we say thank you again for your amazing grace, for allowing your body to be torn apart, paying the price for us. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your blood that was shed, that we could be forgiven, cleansed and renewed. And we invite you now as we take bread and drink wine. Come and renew our faith in you. We pray in Christ Jesus' name. Amen.
Jesus, be glorified.
dying, you restored our death. Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come again in glory, honor, and wonder. We're going to close our service by singing together one day when we all get to heaven. Let's stand and let's sing. Day, Jesus said, as the Father sends me, so I send you. Come, Holy Spirit, empower us with your love, inspire us with your life. Our worship now, Lord, is ended, but our service begins. So we go in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.